Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC Reset Live Lecture. Dear friends, as you know that we are going on with our series on history of English literature very successfully, and so far we have conducted numerous sessions under this very series. Dear friends, in this session today we would be discussing on the Age of Dryden as well as the Dryden as poet and dramatist. And for this very discussion we have once again with us within our studios Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya. Dear friends, I would like to tell you all that Professor Dahiya is a professor beyond boundaries, because he has students both in India and abroad, and his immense experience would definitely help us out in knowing more about Dryden. So I would like to welcome our guest, Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya. Hello sir, welcome to the Edisit lecture.
Well, in this lecture we will discuss the Age of Dryden, which roughly is later 17th century. Dryden's own years are, he was born in 1631 and lived up to the end of the century, 1700. So roughly the later half of the 17th century is the Age of Dryden. But then between the Renaissance and the Age of Dryden, there is half a century which must be taken account of, which means the early 17th century, the first half of the 17th century. Now, during that period, several things happened in the history of English literature. One of them was John Milton. John Milton is considered the tallest poet in English literature. Shakespeare more of a dramatist. So among the poets, Milton is considered the tallest. And he is known by his epic Paradise Lost, which is based on the Bible, and then its sequel Paradise Regained, again based on the Bible. So you can imagine his orientation. His orientation is religious, but then in religion he was with the Puritans, who had revolted against Orthodox Christianity, which is Catholicism. So Oliver Goldsmith, who was the Prime Minister at that time, Milton was on his side, Oliver Cromwell. So Cromwell's rebellion nature, in a way, gets reflected in Milton's Satan and Milton's own rebellion spirit acting against orthodoxy in Christianity. So all that goes into that epic, the only epic, in fact, worth the name, written by an English poet. Spenser's Faerie Queen at times is considered an epic, but it's not really an epic in that sense. Not in the tradition of the Homeric epic or Virgilian epic, those Greco-Roman classical epics. Milton's epic is very much in the classical mold, with the only difference that Milton did away with rhyme. He wrote in blank verse. So, with this religious orientation, imitating the classics, continuing in the tradition of the Greco-Roman epic poetry, Milton held the ground in the early 17th century. Another thing that happened during the first half of the 17th century was the emergence of John Donne and a school called the Metaphysical School of Poetry. The metaphysical poetry, headed by John Donne, excelled in the use of wit. Their orientation remained religious, very much like Milton's, in fact, even more orthodox than Milton's. But John Donne, and right up to Marvel, in between George Herbert, these poets, they relied upon wit as the main instrument of poetry, main device of poetry. And the wit was largely defined by its role in reconciliation of the opposites. So they played upon the opposites like body and soul, earth and heaven, material, spiritual, so on and so forth. Good and evil, all these opposites, they will play upon and bring about reconciliation or resolution through the wit. This was the special feature of metaphysical poetry. The third thing that had happened before Dryden came on the scene in the first half of the 17th century was the emergence of cavalier poets. Cavalier poets were several, and they were followers of Charles the First, the King of England. So loyalists, just as Milton and the metaphysicals were loyalists to religion, to the Bible. So these poets were loyalists to the king, to the royalty. So what is common between them is their sort of orthodoxy, not radical. They may seem radical, both Milton and Donne, but essentially their roots are in religion. That's why Milton wrote ecclesiastic sonnets, and Donne wrote his similar kind of short poems, which were based on the Bible. So, in all the three phenomena of the early 17th century, John Milton, the metaphysicals, and the cavalier poets, Robert Herrick being the main among them, the common thing is their conservatism. It may be political conservatism, it may be religious conservatism, both being loyal to the text or the throne. That's common among them. So these three things had come up during the early part of the 17th century, means the first half. In the second half, we have John Dryden, and that is called the Age of Dryden, himself born in 1631. So obviously he came of age in the 50s, which means middle of the 17th century. So his career as a poet, his career as a man of letters, as a dramatist, as a literary theorist, literary critic, that falls within the second half of the 17th century. He died in 1700. So several things had happened by then. After all, literature cannot be de-linked from history. It is a product of history. Like civilization, culture, and literature. And in fact, the entire thought, our outlook, that is conditioned by the historical forces, historical factors. After all, we are living in an environment. We are not living in vacuum. And that environment, call it social, political, even universal, or geographic, these forces of environment, they determine the kind of literature that gets produced in a particular age. So, in the age of Dryden, the literature that came up was largely satirical. It is classical in its own way, but better known by satire. So, satirical poetry came of age and became predominant during this age, the age of Dryden, for the first time. The essential feature of this poetry was reliance upon certain wit, not the metaphysical wit, but then wit which is secular, wit which is social, wit which operates on the level of everyday life. It is that which is central to the neoclassical poetry, which was initiated by John Dryden. Now, in this age of Dryden, a few things had happened which determined ultimately the kind of literature we have. One of them was that materialism was having the better now of spiritualism. More and more materialistic outlook was becoming dominant in society. The reason was that after the Renaissance, industrialization had begun. And industrialization, of course, will promote materialism because you are then involved in material progress, not in spiritual meditation on the good and evil of life or God and so on. So now it is man-made universe. And in this material outlook, your thought gets restricted to the social man, man in society. Not a special creature created by God, sent on earth to govern here and so on. So that special status goes with the advent of materialism, and man is reduced to the social animal. And therefore, he is to be studied in the context of society, not in the context of God, not in relation to any religious theology. So that was one difference that came about in the 17th century materialism. Another historical factor that became prominent during this period, 17th century, was commercialism. Because of the industrial production, it was natural that commercial activity will get activated, will get accelerated. Hence, commercial activity increased manifold during this period. It was this very period when the British moved out. They came to Asia, they went to Africa. In fact, ultimately, they ended up ruling us and other states in these two continents. So this phenomenon of commerce, and it was commercialism which had brought them here. The spice trade, the spice route from Europe to India, it was in search of that they had come. So commercialism became the accelerator for the materialistic outlook. So commercialism was another factor. And third force that had become prominent during the 17th century was urbanization. For the first time now, the towns were developing, the cities were developing, and England, like any other country of Europe, was no longer a rural society. So now nature is being overtaken by the civilized, cultured world, and hence the activities of the social man and the industrial society's new requirements. So all these factors, they contributed towards producing a new kind of literature. The Age of Dryden produced satires, because now the focus is man and society. Even the writers of thought, philosophers of the time, like John Locke, they also focused on man as a social animal, man in society. No longer the Platonic Republic or Aristotle's books, because they addressed a different world altogether and on a different plane altogether. But now these social scientists, these philosophers of the age, 17th century, they focused on the social man, man in society. So the entire thought of the period is geared towards limiting man to earth and earthly life. So obviously, when your focus is man in society, man on earth, you will be looking into the faults, the shortcomings, the limitations, rather than the aspirations and dreams of man. During the Renaissance, we saw that there were those flights of imagination, those spiritual flights into the heaven and hell. Now, heaven and hell were gone. You were limited to earth. Your abode was here and now, and nothing beyond. So obviously, in such a situation, your focus is all the time man himself. And it is natural to find fault with what he is doing. So this poetry of the Age of Dryden focused on the faults of man, limits of man. In this context, I am reminded of Alexander Pope's lines, Essay on Man, if you remember. He wrote two, he calls them essays, they are actually poems written in verse. But then, since it is a thoughtful piece on the subject of man, he calls it an essay on man. Similarly, an essay on poetry, on the subject of what is poetry, here on the subject of what is man. Now, in this poem, and Pope, you know, is again the culmination of the neoclassical age. Dryden makes the beginning, and Pope makes the climax. So, between the two of them is the period of the neoclassical literature. Dryden as the fountainhead, and Pope as the flowering of the movement. Now, Pope in that essay on man says this about man: born but to die, and reasoning but to err, alike in ignorance is reason such, whether he thinks too little or too much, chaos of thought and passion all confused. So it's a very depressing picture of man. Think of the picture that you have during the Renaissance, Sidney, Spencer, Shakespeare, Marlowe. The view of man, the picture of man is lofty. There it is an idealized view of man, that man is next to God and has those qualities. But here he is presented as a wretched species. A wretched species, neither clear in thought nor clear in emotions, not knowing where to go next, so confused all the time. And one thing is certain, born to die. So mortal, mortality is supreme, and therefore within the umbrella and dominance of mortality, man works obviously very strict conditions, and the view also becomes narrow. It is natural. The view of such a man and in such conditions would become very narrow. So that's why in the Age of Dryden, ending with that of Pope, we have this view of man, rather degraded, rather depressed, as against the lofty view that we saw during the Renaissance. So that's gone now. Another lines that come to mind: know then thyself, again Pope, presume not God to scan. Know then thyself, presume not God to scan. The proper study of mankind is man. So that's a rebuke and an advice to man. Don't look up to God. Don't look up to heavens. You have nothing to do with that, and you know very little about it. Therefore, your proper subject of study is you yourself. So the proper study of mankind is man. So mind your own business and don't think of higher things of which you know nothing. So these limitations are imposed in the Age of Dryden. And that's why the kind of drama you have during the Age of Dryden. He was primarily a dramatist, although, as I said earlier also, a poet and dramatist during that age was still considered the same. There was no difference between the poet and the dramatist. dramatist was also called a poet. So Dryden was both a poet and a dramatist. And dramas also he wrote in poetry. In fact, his limitation was more than Shakespeare's, more than Marlowe's, that he never deviated from the rhymed couplet. Two lines rhyming at the end with each other. The end sounds of both the lines are the same. That is rhymed couplet, just as we have in Urdu Ghazal, all written in two-line couplets and the couplet lines rhyming with each other. So Dryden wrote his plays in rhymed couplet, which was a severe limitation, because then your energies, your attention is consumed by the subject of rhyming. So rhyming gets preference to what is being said, the subject, the thought, the ideas, the emotions, they become secondary, because you are all the time worried about whether or not the two lines are rhyming at the end. They have the same sound. So sound rather than sense takes the priority. So obviously that became a disadvantage. And that's why Dryden's dramas remained unpopular. Unpopular because they were based upon a theory. And the medium restricted to rhymed couplet. Whereas in Shakespeare, you had all the freedom. You could write in rhymes, you could write in blank verse, you could write in other stanzaic forms. So all sorts of possibilities were open to the poet. But now all those options are closed. And you are confined to just one thing, and that is rhymed couplet. So that being the medium of poetry, that being the medium of your thought, obviously it will produce a very limited kind of poetry. So that is what happened to Dryden, both in his dramas as well as poems. We will come to it in more details. But then in this age, not only Dryden, in fact, it had begun with Ben Jonson. Ben Jonson was the father of the neoclassical school. It was called neoclassical because the poets, beginning with Ben Jonson, ending with Alexander Pope, in fact, even Samuel Johnson. This line of poets, they subscribed to neoclassicism, means they were imitators of the classics. Classics, Greek or Roman. They would imitate Homer, they will imitate Virgil, and will try to write their kind of epics, that kind of poetry, long poem. But they were unable to do that. The conditions of the age did not permit the writing of long epics. Hence, short epics, satirical epics, which are called comic epics. I think we stop here. Resume maybe next time. Thank you. Well, in this lecture, we will discuss Dryden as poet and dramatist. Dryden was a versatile writer, genius one can call, because he was a poet and a dominant one in his age. Then he was a dramatist, again a dominant dramatist of his time. And third, he was a theorist, both of drama and poetry. His famous essay on dramatic poesy of 1660. Now that, or 68, sorry, that explains his multidimensional personality, his talent, and he rightly dominated the age with a number of plays, dramas, and a large body of poetry. And then, you see, critical essays, theoretical as well as practical. So, this much output covering all the dominant forms of literature of his time, and then theory and criticism of literature, largely poetry and drama, because until the time of Dryden, we didn't have prose fiction, we didn't have novel. So literature was confined to drama and poetry. So Dryden wrote both. His drama, as I said, he wrote in rhymed couplet. And his kind of drama, this particular brand of drama, was known in his time as heroic drama, just as heroic poetry. So in place of heroic poems, the epics, like Homer's The Iliad and The Odyssey, or Virgil's epics. Now, these poets of the age of Dryden, since they were unable to write those long poems, epics, they produced shorter versions of that kind of poetry. So it is called heroic, both drama and poetry, the kind that Dryden and his followers and his contemporaries wrote. It is called heroic drama. And as I said, the main feature was that the entire play was written in blank verse, sorry, in rhymed verse. How restricted the whole thing was, because in Shakespeare, in Marlowe, they had the freedom to move from one kind of verse to another kind of verse, from rhymed verse to blank verse, from a rhymed couplet to longer stanzas of varying rhyme schemes, ABBA, ABBA, or ABCD, ABCD, CDE, CDE, all sorts of combinations of rhyme were available to them and they exploited all. So they had the freedom, liberty. But here, Dryden himself had curtailed his freedom. He had restricted himself to just one kind of rhyme scheme, that was couplet. So writing a drama in rhymed couplet is contrary to the very spirit of drama itself, because drama is essentially for people's entertainment. It is for the audience. You are not writing for your own satisfaction. You are not giving expression to your private thoughts and emotions. You are writing for the public. So it must address the public interests. It must address the popular themes and attitudes of the people. But then Dryden was not doing that. He had confined himself to a very elitist kind of writing. Elitist because common people do not speak in rhymed couplets. They speak in blank verse, if at all, or they speak in prose. So, far away from the common idiom of the people, common speech of the people, common way of thinking and feeling of the people, here was drama and then poetry, which was an imitation of the classics, Greek or Roman. And besides the imitation, the only new thing it had added was the satire. So satire has to be negative, because in satire you have to hit the enemy, you have to hit whatever you are talking about. It may be a person, it may be an emotion or an idea. The whole thing is directed towards attacking this, undermining it, demolishing it. And that is what Dryden and then later Pope were doing. They were demolishing their rivals. Like Dryden's poem, Macflecknoe. What is that poem about? He had a contemporary poet called Thomas Sedwill. So Sedwill was a rival to Dryden. So to ridicule him, to undermine his position, to make fun of him as a poet, Dryden wrote Macflecknoe, calling him Macflecknoe, a fictitious name, not altogether fictitious. There was such a funny character in history. Son of Flecknoe. Macflecknoe means son of Flecknoe. So Dryden creates this poem only to ridicule and to hit hard his rival, Sedwill. Similarly, he wrote the other long poem, Absalom and Achitophel, where again he's only proving his loyalty to the king, and he is hitting hard the opponents of the king. In other words, it is a political poem. And he's taking sides in the politics of the time. So it was this kind of poetry. Poetry addressed to the contemporary politics. Poetry addressed to contemporary society, its ills, its wrongdoings, its unpalatable practices, maybe in domestic life, maybe in public life. So all that became the subject matter of literature, both in the dramatic form as well as the poetic form. And Dryden limited himself to this, not only rhymed verse as medium, rhymed couplet, but also to the scope of the subject matter. That also he made very narrow for himself. So obviously, operating in the narrow range would cut on your imagination, because you can't move very far. You have drawn boundaries around yourself. So your heart, your mind, they are restricted by the boundaries that are drawn around them. There were no such boundaries during the Renaissance. That's why Renaissance literature sounds very open. It's very very elevating. It gives you a sense of exhilaration, like you are having a flight. You are flying into the universe. But when you come down to the Age of Dryden, the feeling is as if you have landed from that flight onto the earth. That difference. So because Dryden and company, they thought that Renaissance was a kind of holidaying. They had eschewed their social duties, their domestic responsibilities, and they were having a good time roaming about in the open, freelancers. So this was the image of the Renaissance, that Dryden and Pope or the neoclassical age formed. So obviously not a very lofty view, not a very positive view of universe, man, the thought, philosophy, literature, all was, you see, dubbed as something irresponsible, something like taking a holiday from your normal duties of life. So they wanted to bring back the literary stream of England to the serious classical mode. That is why they focused on the imitation of the classics. Whatever the Greco-Roman poets did in the ancient time, that must be revived, that must be imitated. And that was the highest kind of flight of literary imagination, which must be brought back. So that is what Dryden attempted, and he imitated the classics. That is why Ben Jonson, rather than Shakespeare, became the mentor for the neoclassical poets, because Ben Jonson had classical orientation. Shakespeare didn't have. Shakespeare was just school education, he had to his credit. Thereafter, never went to the university, never had that higher education. That is why Ben Jonson could say that he knew very little Latin and less Greek. So in a way, very derogatory remark that Shakespeare was no scholar. He had not much education to his credit. So Dryden belonged to that very school of Ben Jonson. So did Pope. So did, in fact, later Dr. Samuel Johnson. So this line of the neoclassical poets, from Dryden to Pope to Johnson, Samuel Johnson. So this period of later 17th century, and then of course 18th century when Pope and Johnson come, this century, so to say, between the mid-17th to the mid-18th, this century of English literature, called the Neoclassical Age, between Dryden and Pope and Johnson, they focused on the narrow range of themes confined to man as a social animal and limited to the medium of rhymed couplet. So both ways, in content and form, in subject and shape, both ways, there were severe limitations, restrictions, which were of course self-imposed, but they were restrictions all the same. And that is why Dryden's drama, although he wrote several, like The Indian Queen, Aurangzeb, All for Love, Troilus and Cressida, Don Sebastian, you see these important plays, and very great in their own right, but limited, as I said, severely damaged by its being elitist, both in the subject matter as well as the style or form. So subject, style, form, all tended to or towards the limited space. So that's why, as I said, it was not a popular drama like Shakespeare's. Dryden's plays remained closet plays, plays which are meant for a coterie, meant for the elitist audience, meant for only those who knew the classics, who knew the meters, who knew the sophistications of wit, how it operates, because satire is not a straight talk. Satire, by its very definition, is you say one thing but mean another. You say, oh, what a great man he is. Actually, you are saying that he is a wretched man. So, what you say and what you intend, there is a vast difference between the two. So it was this kind of literature, be it drama, be it poetry, that Dryden wrote, and his followers or his fellow poets wrote during the age of Dryden, which means later 17th century. So his two famous poems, like his plays, Mac Flecno and Absalom and Achitophel, both were again limited by two different things. First, limited to hitting an individual, a rival poet, Thomas Shadwell. Now, this is not a very popular theme. You may have your rivalry with a fellow poet, But the entire population of England does not share your interest. They are not interested in the first place in poetry as such. Secondly, they are not interested in your rivalry with another poet. That is your personal affair, your personal quarrel. So it can't be a very popular subject. So when you are writing about somebody, you are writing for your own satisfaction or for the limited world of poets or the sophisticated readers of poetry. So this limited elitist world, which is sophisticated because of its education, because of its higher level of thinking, reading, attainment in literature and education, it cannot be popular by its very nature. So the choice was Dryden's, but age also put limitations because they were crazy about writing in the style and form of the classics, the ancient great poets. Now you cannot do that. History moves forward. You cannot repeat history. Nothing gets repeated, as somebody has said. Marx said it, in fact, Karl Marx, that history never repeats itself. If it does, it becomes a farce. What was heroic once becomes a farce. Napoleon is repeated by Napoleon III, who was a farcical figure. So that is what happens when you try to repeat history. So Dryden and company, they are trying to repeat history in literature. They are trying to bring back the classical age, which is no longer there. You cannot bring back the past. You cannot relive it because it is gone. Whatever is gone is gone. So the imitation has to be a poor imitation. That is why not epics, mock epic. Epic by nature is not, you say, non-serious. It's not mocking. It's not a fun. It's something serious. Our epics like Mahabharata or Ramayana, for example, you don't go to them to get fun. You don't go to them to get enjoyment of wit or satire. You go to them for moral engagement with life, with serious engagement with the larger issues of life, which are beyond the individual self, higher self, higher knowledge, higher thinking. So that is what epics would do. And epics used to be comprehensive, not personal but public. Here the poetry of the age of Dryden became rather private, a private affair between two poets, hitting each other, making fun of each other, pulling each other's leg. Of course you can do that. You can please yourself. But then you can't expect the public at large to share your sentiments, to become a party to your jealousies, to your animosities, and to your satirical ridiculing of your rival. So Dryden does that in Macflecknoe. And similarly, he makes fun of those who were opposed to Charles the First in Absalom and Achitophel. So Gymri and company, he makes fun of them, those political rivals of the king. So you are taking sides, and you can't expect everybody to be on your side. There will be people who will be on the other side as well. So these were the limitations which were self-imposed. Otherwise, Dryden was a great poet, great talent, a master of verse and verse techniques, forms, very well read in the classics, and therefore had no difficulty in imitating them. But then all that drove him into the closed world of books, closed world of the past, which is no longer there. And you are trying to do something impossible, trying to revive the past which is not there. So it is this way that Dryden moved from drama to poetry. And the essay on dramatic poesy, which is literary theory or literary criticism, there also he is limiting himself because he is trying to justify only the kind of drama he wrote and the kind of poetry that he wrote. So you are tying yourself to one style of writing, one form of writing, and you are not open to the other types, the other forms, the other styles. So this was a serious limiting factor. Otherwise, a great talent, a great poet, in his own limited style and form, he remains a great name in the history of English literature. But then, if you place him in the overall context of literature, beginning with the classics, then of course his space is very small, his space is very narrow. I think I stop here. Thank you.
With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. And today we had a deep, deep discussion on the age of Dryden, and we discussed about Dryden as a poet and dramatist. Dear friends, in our next session, that is in our next lecture, we would be discussing on the age of pop. So, dear friends, if you have liked this lecture, or if you have any kind of question or a feedback which you would like to give us, then you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again very soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.